We're used to thinking of wars as long-term events, with many casualties and unparalleled destruction. There's no doubt that many of you have wondered, what was the longest war ever fought? But what about the shortest? In this video, we are going to explore what's known as the shortest war in history. Stay tuned to learn more. This is a great example of unbelievable arrogance. What's termed as the Anglo-Zanzibar War, the British Empire essentially were looking to give the arrogant and unyielding Sultan, Khalid bin Bargash, a chance to regain his senses and not trying to fight the British army in hopes that he can retain power. Of course, Britain being a superpower at the time, completely obliterated the Sultan and his army in 38 minutes. However, this war, out of context, seems like the British were just abusing their power and bullying the small country of Tanzania. But that's not exactly the case. By the late 1800s, Britain had extended its long arm in hopes that it could achieve the renowned phrase, the empire on which the sun never sets. In this case, most of East Africa was subject to British rule. With its extended arm over East Africa, one of the major points that they were able to control was Zanzibar. Zanzibar, in the early 1800s, was beginning to rapidly expand their merchant services globally. The three major trades that Zanzibar participated in were spices, ivory tusks, and slaves. Yes, they would actively trade and provide slaves as if they were some kind of commodity. In fact, this is the main reason why the 38-minute war took place at all. Continuing on, after the first half of the century passed, both the British and the Germans began expanding beyond their own continent. Obviously, this caused a major rift in the growth of Zanzibar because there was no chance to fight against these military giants. So, what was once a unified country was now partitioned between two major countries. We can consider that Germany and Britain had a pseudo-war. It was really more of an indirect war over Zanzibar, and of course, this was done through as much bribing as possible, in which case, the British managed to get the upper hand. At this point, the British allowed Zanzibar to function as it would if there were no rulers, but they had to submit to two major policies. Before we continue filling you in on the context, we want to give you a question to think about. How many casualties do you think happened on the British side? Keep watching to find out. The first policy was to restore the major mercantile status and to abolish slavery. The rich Zanzibari merchants were pretty upset hearing about these policies. However, the policy that upset them was the abolition of slavery. The reason being that they believed this to be the reason why their merchant trade was so strong. Now, let's reintroduce that rebellious man who attempted to declare himself Sultan. Initially, Britain selected Hamad bin Thuwain, but the proud Khalid refused to let this happen. He exclaimed that he is the only true successor to the Sultan, which the British slyly responded that the Sultan's succession is not done by familial ties anymore. The British managed to subdue Khalid's fury for now. Funnily enough, even Hamad lost his acquiescence to the British rule. He created a 1,000-man army that was only loyal to the Sultan. He ended up passing away the same year that he began his small army. So, guess who appeared again with these big words? You guessed it. Khalid now wouldn't stand down and actually forcibly seized the royal palace and its harem. At this point, Khalid expanded the previous 1,000-man army into a 3,000-man army in the royal battle yacht called Glasgow. In response to this, the not-so-worried Basil Cave assembled a small army with 400 Zanzibari soldiers and British Marines. He also was backed by 5 very powerful Royal Navy vessels. Again, we stress the point as to the arrogance of Khalid thinking he could win this war. The Rear Admiral, Harry Rawson, gave Khalid an ultimatum. He basically said that he's giving Khalid and his troops 1 hour to exit the palace and its grounds and to surrender their arms or face British firepower. Are you enjoying the video so far? Why not like it? If you enjoy these types of videos, then consider subscribing to the channel. Don't forget to ring the notification bell to get the latest updates. Obviously, Khalid refused, and now we enter into the shortest war ever recorded in history. Over the course of 38 minutes, from 9 a.m. August 27th to 9:38 a.m. on the same day, 3 of the 5 Royal Navy vessels bombed the royal palace quickly, causing 500 deaths to Khalid's troops. On the British end, there was only one casualty. Since the British seemingly didn't like to waste time, they enacted their policies later in the afternoon and managed to give the title of Sultan to the man they initially wanted. The malleable Sayyid Hamoud obviously agreed to the British policies, knowing very well that he could be demolished within half an hour. As an interesting fact, Khalid fled to German territory near Zanzibar, but was arrested by the British during World War I. I guess he couldn't escape forever? So, what did you think of the shortest war in history? Have you heard about this war before? Do you know any other short wars in history? Let us know in the comments below. Thank you for watching and see you later.